series of seminars, but it's still, I hope, interesting for many of you. I work in a national infrastructure in Portugal. They have to provide services to researchers, and we provide high-performance computing services, high-throughput computing services, cloud services, and of course for us virtualization is a very important tool, but it also is used by many of you. I would like to know just if you are using VirtualBox or something like that. At least a few of you are for sure, many probably more and are afraid of telling. So there are many types of virtualization. For instance, network virtualization that is available and widely used since the 90s with the virtual LANs and virtual switches now and stuff like that. Storage virtualization with logical volumes that can be provided by storage area networks and by technologies such as, for instance, Ceph. But those don't matter to us today. We will be focusing on computer virtualization to understand a bit how it works. And then we'll look at operating system level virtualization, containers. And we'll see what are the advantages of containers versus the conventional virtual machines. So what is a virtual machine? There are probably many definitions. I like this one. Virtual machine is an efficient, isolated duplicate of a real computer machine. And I like the fact that this comes from a paper called Formal Requirements for Virtualizable Third Generation Architectures from 1974. So in 1974, there was these guys, Gerald P. Popek and Robert Goldberg, writing about what should be the third generation of architectures for virtualization, which meant that there were already two at the time. And the efficiency here is a very nice aspect, because what they say that efficient is in this context is the number of instructions that you need to execute for running your application versus the number of instructions that you need to use, additional instructions that you need to use in a virtualized environment. And this means that a virtual machine is not only a duplicate of the original machine, is also something that exhibits a similar performance. So typically what we have is obviously a physical machine, and then we have a layer typically constituted by software and hardware, or maybe just software as we'll see. And on top of this layer, we can have these virtual machines orchestrated by the virtualization layer. And these virtual machines may have different storage capacities, different amounts of memory, different operating systems, and so forth. So this provides a lot of flexibility, especially in data centers. A bit of history. Actually, virtualization was born in the 1960s, so it's not new at all. If you think it is new, it isn't. Actually, it was born before 1966. The first projects for virtualization started with the requirements of having interactivity and time sharing in mainframes that at the time were mostly batch-oriented. They executed one program at a time. And then they wanted to execute multiple programs at the same time, and they decided, and they started to design things like virtual memory and virtual address spaces and that kind of stuff. And then this project of 1966 from IBM introduced this nice concept of this control program that could be run on top of the machine. This is the virtualization layer. And on top of this control program, you could run several operating systems at the same time. An interesting thing here is that these operating systems could run directly either in the hardware or on top of the CPU and modify it. And this is quite something, because this is only achievable in x86 architectures, on Intel architectures, already in this century. Okay? So these guys were able to do it, and to this we call nowadays an hardware virtual machine. So this was quite successful and entered in production around 1967 with the IBM System 360. Probably there is no one here from the 1980s and something like that, but when I started to work on those things back in 1988 or something like that, I remember of using the CERN VM. CERN VM was the mainframe at CERN that used exactly this combination. It used the CP and the CMS. An interesting thing here was that the CMS operating system exhibited a lot of the virtualization things to the user. So the user had its own virtual punch card, virtual printer, and virtual mini disks. So it was an interesting concept. But it actually didn't took off outside of the IBM world. Why? Because then microprocessors were much more cheaper, and they were cheaper because they were also simpler, and there was no room in there to put or interest in putting virtualization in there. And then these things took off mainly, especially for PCs and the likes in 1999 with VMware. Then for Linux with 2000 with user mode Linux, which was the first attempt to provide virtualization in the Linux world. And then it really took off with in 2003 with the Xen virtualization system for Linux. So types of virtualization. First, without virtualization, we have what is called bare metal, which is running directly in the hardware. So whenever you hear about bare metal, running on bare metal, you are running directly on the hardware. Then typically what happens is that you consolidate, at least in the data centers, a lot of the bare metal using virtualization. So you make these virtual machines, these physical machines, running as virtual machines on top of the same hardware, adding the hypervisor, the virtualization layer over here. So you end up having, in this case, two virtual machines and two different operating systems in each virtual machine, and then same applications again running here. An important concept here is of the guest operating system and host operating system. Host operating system is the operating system of the physical machine in this case. Guest is the operating systems of the virtual machine. Of course, the host can be also a virtual machine because you can get, in certain cases, nested virtualization. What is the interesting thing here for data centers is that you save space with this because you have less machines. You save energy because you have also less machines and more efficient machines, typically. You have less hardware to manage. You get faster provisioning, which means that you can put the machines available to the users faster. Instead of having to install physical machines, you can just take what is usually called a golden image and start the system from a predefined golden image and make it work in seconds. And of course, this is much more efficient and flexible. So in terms of virtualization, there are mainly three types. The first is not really virtualization, is more usually called emulation. And this is when you want to run two operating systems, one in the host and of the guest, without having any assistance from the hardware. So you don't have any assistance for virtualization in the hardware. You don't get any assistance from the CPU to do virtualization, and you want to run virtualization somehow without modifying the operating systems of the host and of the guest. And then in that circumstance, the only way that you can do it is with emulation. You are not running the instructions directly in the hardware. You are interpreting those instructions, at least the instructions that are privileged, the instructions that run in privileged modes. The instructions that are run in the user mode, the actual, let's say, code of the application, can, in many cases, still be executing in the hardware. But then the instructions that would run at the level of the operating system in the guest, they are trapped and they are interpreted. For paravirtualization, this is the thing that Xen, for instance, in Linux does, and that is the thing that really made virtualization took off. Basically here, the idea is that to get virtualization, you need to do it, let's say, you need to opt to change the operating system. Okay, so in this case of paravirtualization, you are using modified operating systems, kernels, both in the host and both in the guest. Okay, so why are the operating systems modified? You need these, especially if you don't have any assistance from the hardware to provide the virtualization. And in that case, what you do is that the operating system of the guest calls and performs many of the operations through the host operating system. So there is a set of calls, that's the hyper calls, that can be performed by the guest operating system to the host operating systems to access the hardware. And this is what Xen does. More recently, you have, for instance, KVM in the Linux world that takes advantage of virtualization instructions that are available on Intel and the AMD CPUs. And for that, what happens is that you don't need to change the operating system itself. The operating system is, in fact, the same. What you need to run is an additional set of software that will run in a special way in the hardware and that will coordinate the operating systems that are virtualized on top of it. And how does this work, actually? So in a typical, and this is an x86 architecture, you get several levels of privileges in the operating system, in the CPU. So you have these rings. Typically, you have the operating system kernel running on ring 0. Ring 1 and ring 2 are not used on Linux. And then you have the applications running on ring 3, which is the less privileged mode. And of course, if you have two operating systems, you cannot have two operating systems running at the same time trying to access the hardware on ring 0 because they would conflict between each other. So what is the solution? The solution is that you put an additional ring, the ring minus 1, that is provided in the, let's say, more recent CPUs from Intel AMD that have VTX and AMDV, which is a set of instructions that enables virtualization on those CPUs. And basically, you have a set of software that runs here that is the hypervisor. And this software is the software that does the arbitration of the operating systems that will be running on ring 0. So operating system level virtualization. This is usually called containers. Probably some of you have already heard the term. So what is the idea behind? The idea is that do we really need to use hypervisors and have these sophisticated and heavy virtualization, conventional virtualization that we use for doing everything? Well, it depends a lot. If you want to run two different operating systems, such as Windows and Linux, on the same machine, then there is no other proper way to run without virtualization, because they are too different. And you really need to have virtualization. Okay, you can run certain applications with Wine. For instance, this presentation is being done on a machine that is Linux, but actually I'm using Office. And what I'm using here to run Office is Wine. And Wine is a system that enables you to run certain Windows applications on Linux without virtualization. It's just a set of libraries, let's say, that translate in certain way the APIs from Windows to Linux. So, and this works pretty well. But you cannot run a full-blown Windows operating system with this. So you need virtualization. If you want to have additional security, because sometimes we use virtualization for having additional security, well, virtualization might be something that improves a bit security. There are also flaws in virtualization, and especially if you are using paravirtualization, the flaws in the guest kernel can be exploited to access the host kernel, and that happened before. But, okay, I could accept that this is acceptable, but there are other ways of doing it without using full virtualization. Then, for instance, another thing, to have a better resource allocation, allocate a certain amount of memory or a certain amount of CPU time or a certain amount of cores to a certain application. And a lot of people have been using virtualization for this. Actually, there is no reason to use virtualization for doing resource allocation. You can do it better in other ways. Also for flexible infrastructure provisioning. So that means, okay, manage more easily the infrastructure and the services that you have. For instance, allowing services to be migrated from one machine to another machine and things like that. With virtualization, you can do this pretty well, but there are also other ways of doing it without virtualization. Then another thing that some of you have faced for sure is when you need a different environment. You need a different set of libraries, you need a different set of compilers to run your application different from the ones available in the host. And you would like to have a different environment. Sometimes people use virtualization for this, so that they can instantiate a machine with a specific environment to run a specific application. But there are other ways of doing this, as you will see. And this became more or less recently available before. And actually, it was because of these reasons and because many of these things were not available in the Linux kernel in the past that some people end up saying that hypervisor were the living proof that the operating systems were incompetent, because operating systems were not able to do these things which supposedly would be, expectable that they would provide such things. But things have evolved. And in fact, depending on the purpose, using hypervisors and virtual machines can be the wrong tool for the job. And we'll see that an option to virtualization, to full virtualization, and remember that full virtualization means running an hypervisor on top of the hardware, having virtual machines, and running operating systems on those virtual machines, and then running the applications on top. Instead of doing all this, what you want is to have basically different computing environments with different libraries, with different requirements, basically you can do it much more easily by using the same operating system and just provide isolated environments. An environment here that has certain libraries and a certain runtime environment, and another one completely isolated here that has a different runtime environment, and then you can run your applications in the same way as if you were running them in a full virtualized environment. And this is operating system level virtualization. Provisioning of isolated environments in the same operating system without the need of having virtualization, hypervisors, and duplicated operating systems. So the advantages, less memory consumption. You have in full virtualization, you have multiple virtual machines, each one with its own operating system that is consuming memory, that is consuming resources. And with operating system level virtualization, you don't have duplication of the operating system. You also don't have a lot of the services that you need to run in a normal machine, like time synchronization, like logging, like monitoring of the hardware, and so forth. You don't need nothing of those, because those are done in the host. And then each isolated environment only has the application and the libraries needed for running the application. And this is, of course, much less management effort. This is becomes much easier to manage and also more flexible. And of course, you get faster I/O usually and less latency because you don't have the overhead of going through the operating systems of the guest and then through the hypervisor until the host and the hardware. This started basically in 1982. We can trace this to the change root system call. The change root system call is something that enables you to start a process in a different hierarchy of the operating of your directory tree. So basically, it redefines the top of the directory tree to become a different directory that may have inside a /lib, a /etc, a /var, etc, with all the runtime needed to run a certain application. So with the system root, change root system call, you could run a certain application or service already in a contained environment. But this was improved in FreeBSD in 1998, with addition of other things besides the file system isolation, with memory limits, CPU quotas, and so forth. And then several products appeared in between that offered similar functionalities, not only for Linux, but for other operating systems, such as Solaris, that had zones that perform, basically were a similar equivalent to the jails in FreeBSD. And actually, many of these things were meant to run sometimes more complex environments, but things change with the appearance in the Linux kernel of certain functionalities that we'll be seeing that started to become available to the end user with the LXC, which is a system that was meant to encapsulate applications, basically. So you can encapsulate applications and services taking advantage of certain features in the Linux kernel using LXC, and this appeared in 2008. And we'll see a bit about LXC, how it works. But it really took off with Docker. Probably you might have already heard about Docker, and Docker is a very nice system that simplifies a lot the creation of containers so that you can run services and applications in isolated environments in Linux. The kernel functionalities that enable the containers, there are many. The most important ones are the namespaces. And you get several types of namespaces. You get mount namespaces, UTS namespaces, IPC namespaces, network namespaces. And basically what these things enable you is to provide isolation for each one of these things. With mount namespaces, you can get mount points that are visible in the host but are not visible inside of the container. So you can get a vision of the operating system hierarchy that is completely different inside of the container from the one that is available in the host, which is very handy to, of course, build a containerized environment for a given application. With network namespaces, for instance, you can have a complete different network stack with different IP addresses, different firewall, different routing tables, and so forth. So it's a completely independent network environment for the application that you can set up differently from one of the hosts, and so forth. And then there are some other functionalities that are needed for security. One of them is seccomp, because basically within a container, there are system calls that you will not want to call for security reasons, or that simply are not worthwhile to make available. There are about 300 system calls in the Linux operating system, and you don't need all of those for all applications. So we can cut some of those system calls so that the application cannot use them and improve security for the containerized environment, especially if you are running something inside of the container that you don't trust. Another thing is cgroups. Cgroups is a way basically to give resources to applications. You can use it outside of the containers world, and you can use it, for instance, to give a certain amount of RAM to, and limit the amount of RAM that certain process is able to use. You can also use it to do throttling of the I/O of the application. So this enables you to define some quality of service for your containers. Another one is the POSIX capabilities that enable to split the privilege of the root user. In the past, the root user was the whole mighty powerful that had privilege to do everything. With the POSIX capabilities, you can split the root privileges in a set of privileges, and then, for instance, tell that you have a root user or a root process that is not capable of mounting or creating devices, for instance. And that is something that you want to forbid inside the container if the container is running as root. You don't want that root to be capable of creating devices or accessing, for instance, the RAM of the machine and things like that. It's for security reasons. Those here, seccomp and POSIX capabilities, are mostly for security, and these ones as well. Change root, we already saw what more or less what it is. And AppArmor and SELinux, you know that this is a mandatory access control system for security for the Linux systems, AppArmor in Ubuntu and derivatives, and SE Linux mainly on Red Hat derivatives. It's optional when you are running containers, but it increases the security. If you think that you are not using namespaces, or namespaces are an odd thing, you are wrong, because if you go into any Linux machine that you may have access, and you do this, and it's very simple, and $$, if you probably know that it means the process itself, so it's a reference to the PID of the LS process itself, and you do this, you will see this. And what this means is that LS here is running already in namespaces, in any machine. You are already, by default, using namespaces. They are already there. It's just that you are using the default namespaces that were set up in the boot of the machine. But they are already there. And what we do with the operating system level virtualization with containers is basically to move the processes to different namespaces. If you move them to different namespaces, then they become isolated and cannot see some things that are available in the host or available in other containers. Sorry. So basically a container. A container runs programs and processes in a standard way, no emulation or hypervisors, just process isolation, and therefore they are usually more efficient. You get this type of concentric thing in which you have the application in the middle, then you can secure the applications isolate to provide additional security using seccomp, system call filtering, disabling some of the system calls. Then you can have you can have namespaces to isolate the applications and make the things such as something running in a container does not see the other containers and does not see the host. And then you can have seccomp around to filter the system calls. And then you can have optionally, usually SELinux or AppArmor to isolate things even further if you are really concerned with security. So putting it all together, let's assume that we have an Ubuntu host and a machine running Ubuntu, and you want to put a container in there. You need to get some image of a certain operating system, for instance, CentOS. In this case, putting it in a volume and mounting it with a loopback interface doesn't really matter, but it's there. Then you create a mount namespace, and what you need to do is to mount this volume with CentOS 6 inside of the mount namespace as root. And then you take some tree, for instance, from the Ubuntu host, with the slash home of the Ubuntu host, for instance, and you can mount it with a mount bind inside of the mount namespace. And then any process created here will only see this root, and in this root, this slash home mounted in this root. If you want to get further separation, you can, for instance, create a PID namespace that makes that processes running in the container will not see other processes running in the host. And then you start the program. And the program will run here in this environment completely unaware of what is outside in terms of mount namespaces and PID namespaces. So what do you need to do to create a container? You need your programs. You need the libraries that those programs need to run, basically. And you need to put them in a file system that you can then run inside of a mount namespace. And there is this important question. Can I run another Linux distribution using containers? As we saw in the previous slide, yes, I can run Red Hat on top of Ubuntu, I can run Ubuntu on top of Red Hat, and so forth. So it looks like virtualization, really. And why? Why? Because the kernel abstract binary interface, is basically unchanged across flavors and across the distributions of Linux. So the interfaces that the kernel provides to the outside world, namely to the libc and so forth, they are the same. So if you change, if you keep the same kernel, but then change all the libraries and everything, you can run whatever you want in there. An important thing to consider is there is no miracle. There is no miracle, and many of these operations, as you may suspect, need root privileges. So if you want to do things like mounts and mount binds and things and create namespaces, usually you need privileges to do that, and you need to run them as root. So a normal user and privileged user usually cannot do these things in a system that he does not control. So let's see one of the first tools. One of the first tools that appeared was LXC. LXC was basically a tool that took advantage of the namespaces and other functionalities to enable the encapsulation of services and processes, and basically offered some command line interfaces so that you could create, destroy, start, stop those containers with applications or services. But it was very difficult to set up, because for each application and each service, you need to know a lot about namespaces, you need to know a lot about SecComp, you need to know a lot about all those things so that you could set up the profile for each application and service. So it was not transparent. Then running was easier, but setup was quite difficult. But then, basically the same guys, and this is supported by Ubuntu, came out with LXD that is available on Ubuntu. And this is actually a very interesting system that takes advantage of namespaces and similars. And with that, you can run almost full-blown operating systems with this type of virtualization. If you install this, you can use it basically as an alternative, let's say, to VirtualBox with advantages in saving memory and a lot of other things. So if you are a user of VirtualBox, you can consider that as an option. And this allows to boot a system that has SSHD, that has everything that you basically need to run whatever you need. But is basically available on Ubuntu. It does not have much support outside of Ubuntu because it's pushed much by Canonical, and then there is these wars between Canonical and Red Hat and stuff like that. So. So another thing that is very interesting is Docker. Docker really changed the thing. Okay, Debian, it should work probably on Debian as well. I never tried, but it's Canonical. It's the guys really from Ubuntu that are pushing this a lot, and they are using it also in their own offering of cloud with OpenStack as a kind of hypervisor to run virtual machines on OpenStack. So they are pushing a lot for that, and is really Ubuntu the target for them. Yeah, okay. I never tried it on Debian. On Ubuntu works for sure. It's not packaged. Probably if you take it, you will be able to compile and run, I guess. There is no reason why you shouldn't. But it's the same happens for Red Hat and things like that. They do not provide support for that. Docker. Docker is a very, very interesting thing because it makes everything much simpler. Docker is targeted really to run specific services and specific applications that you want to run in there. So if you want to run, you run each service or application in a container. So let's imagine that you want to have an HTTP server, web server. You can create a container with HTTP in there. Or better, you can take one that already exists. If you have an application, you should run one application in each container. That's the logic. And then you can combine containers as well. So you can have a container with an HTTP server, you can have another container with a database, and then you can make the container of the HTTP server see the database and things like that. And it's very, very, very easy to use. It's oriented to these DevOps principles. DevOps principle in IT is a principle that advocates that operations and development should be done more or less together. Basically, the same people that are doing the development of applications or services are the same people that takes care of running those services and applications in production. And for that, they need a lot of automation. So there, this fits very well, because you can have the developers taking care of the applications, running them in containers, while the operations, the system managers, take care of the infrastructure that runs the containers. So there is a split responsibility. That is very nice. And running something is really very easy. You just take Docker, install it, and then you run. You can do things like Docker run, in this case, interactivity with a terminal attached, and then specify what you want to run. In this case, I'm running a container that is called CentOS, CentOS 6. It's the official CentOS 6 packaging container. So you can, with this, what happens is that Docker will pull a container with CentOS 6 transparently from Docker Hub, and we'll deploy it, and we'll run it. And you get the prompt, and you are on CentOS 6, and you can do cat /etc/release, and you'll see that you are in CentOS 6 release 6.8. That's the one that officially is in the container for CentOS 6 in Docker. Yes. Yes, it's possible as well. If you set up the environment properly, the display and everything, you can have it. You don't access the, let's say, the graphics device directly. You need to go through the X, but without accessing the device directly, as if you were remotely. Okay? So, yes, you don't. Here, it's more difficult to have that. Here is more difficult to have that. Okay? But we'll see other ways. Then, Docker Hub is very nice. You can go to the Docker Hub website, and then you can search there containers that are available, and there is huge amount of containers already packaged for applications, for services, and for everything. You just search, and then you can then run them, pull them and run them, or just run with the name and the tag. Docker is very interesting because they have this concept of the structure of the images, in which each image is made of layers. And each layer has a unique ID. And these unique IDs allow you to share layers. So you can have, for instance, if I want to build something on top of the CentOS 6 layer, I can build on top of that layer. And if I build several things on top of the same layer, I don't need to download that layer several times. Because once I download once, I can build several things on top of it, and it will use the layer that is already there. Layers can be shared. So we have this concept where you can have a base layer. It could be the CentOS 6, for instance. And then you can put on top another layer, let's say, with packages that you add, another layer with the user software that you add, another layer with updates. And you will see all these as a tree, a normal tree. This is completely transparent. It's on different layers. But when you run, you don't notice. It's a normal file system that is there. And this, of course, is very interesting because it saves space, it saves download time, and so forth. So basically, if you want to create a container and you want to do it properly, you should use what is called Docker files. And this is a Docker file. In this Docker file, it has a very simple syntax. In this case, I'm taking as base image CentOS 6, so CentOS 6 will become my base image, the first layer. Then I'm running yum install httpd and the PHP, and the stuff that will be installed will be in a different layer automatically. And then I'm copying Sam's directory from my machine into var www app inside of the container. And this will end up in a third layer automatically. And I'm exposing the port TCP 80, that's the port of HTTP. And then I'm saying which command it should be run by default for this container, which is the HTTP daemon with the options. And basically, that's it. We have an image, and then we can run the image. What happens is that these layers here are read-only, they are constant. So when I'm running, there is a read-write layer that is added, that is transparently added, and any change that you may make during execution is done into this layer. Then, in the end, you can choose two things. Either you scrap out this layer because you copy your results and you get rid of it, or you can commit this layer and this layer becomes a fourth layer within the image. So, Docker is very interesting because it became a kind of industry standard. It's a de facto standard in the industry. This got a huge attraction. The last Docker conference this year got 5,500 people attending. So this is really huge in the industry. This is not a small thing. And all major cloud providers are providing already containers directly. You can instantiate and run containers directly there as you run virtual machines. And it has a huge community behind supporting it. This evolved in an ecosystem because it's no longer Docker. It's Docker and a huge amount of stuff around that enables orchestration and a lot of other things with Docker.